Very warm welcome to everyone. We welcome you to Pratheet, where we think that every approach can be a right approach. So going further, next please, Yojana. So the purpose of having this program, Pratheet, it's a unique knowledge sharing program which we thought of coming with, where we think that this one kind of program which will have the speaker who will share the expertise through their clinical experience and knowledge on a different topic. So we know that always evidence-based medicine is there and experience-based medicine is there. So we always give more weightage to evidence-based, but of course, experience do matter as we live, as we go ahead. So experience sharing is a platform about this. So Pratheet involves a high-level academic discussion in case presentation format, which will be involving interest of therapy cases from field of ENT. These are mainly clinical cases in ENT practice, and each case is different with either comorbid condition or the clinical manifestation. So the detailed discussion and the management approach can lead for a better disease outcome, because I believe there can be two approaches which can be the right approach which we can have. So going further, for today's topic, we have tackling the mucose storm, which has really taken spotlight for if you see the news, the mucor has really come up, the medico radio rhinological challenges. So for which we have the moderator, Dr. Nisit Shah. Next please, Yojana. So Dr. Nisit Shah sir has been a consultant ENT surgeon at Bridge Candy Hospital. He is an honorary senior consultant in ENT at Bombay Hospital and Medical Research Center. He is the past president of All India Rhinology Society and the chairperson, Division of Skull-Based Surgery, Indian Academy of Ortholaryngology and Head and Neck Surgery. He is the head of department and coordinator of guide for DNB National Board and postgraduate program in ENT at Bombay Hospital from 2005 to 2016. The program, he is also a program director for fellowship program in endoscopic sinus and skull-based surgery since February 2007. He is also a director of endoscopic skull-based annual workshop at Bombay Hospital since 2004. Now going further, I would hand over the session to Dr. Nisit sir to introduce the first speaker.
Thank you so much, Rohit, and a very warm welcome to not just the faculty, but to all the delegates and participants. So really what happened is that from all the people who have been our fellows, have done the fellowship program, and we have a nice group of young surgeons. And I found that in the last few months, we were getting a lot of questions coming in on the fellow group about pertaining to mucor, as to, you know, what should be done, or if it is this situation, what can be done, a little bit of surgical discussion, etc. And Danish, Darshan, and everybody else were doing 50, 60 patients a month. And so I was speaking to Danish about, you know, can we do some kind of joint thing so that we can address everyone's questions together at one time and learn from each other's experience. And so this was essentially Danish's idea that we sort of should have a kind of symposium which involves radiology, involves medical treatment, and then an interactive session. And so we've had a lot of input from him to organize the speakers. We wanted the speakers to be generally young and with hands-on experience, you know, in doing all this. It's more the young folk we find that has been tackling mucor with great vigor and determination more than us. But of course, we need the experience and the wisdom of the senior people as well. So we've sort of tried to get a little mix between the two. Our first speaker for the day is one of our senior people. I feel he's one of the leading radiologists in the country, a man dedicated to fantastic level of imaging, not just MRI, CT scan, but also sonography in the head and neck region. Dr. Sanjay Vaid is sort of the head founder of Star Imaging in Pune and has done some amazing work. He's helped us through numerous workshops in FES and skull-based surgery. And I will ask him to to kick off his talk on basically what we are looking for in a mucor in terms of diagnosis, in terms of sort of how widespread it is, and what is better, MRI, CT, etc. Sanjay, over to you.
Thank you very much, Nishit, especially for calling me young. First, I thought you were calling me young, then you brought the senior in. So, thank you so much for that. Okay. I hope my slides and slides are visible, and I hope I'm audible to everybody. thank you so much for inviting me here. Thank you, Danish. Thank you, Nishit, for having me over. So in the next 15 to 20 minutes or so, we'll try and get a little overview of mucor. We'll look at the imaging features, try and see whether we are able to see certain early pointers, which is going to help us into kind of triage patients into a disease positive, likely disease negative category. As Nishit said, look at the modalities, when to do CT, when to do MR. We'll go through the spectrum in the nasal cavity, sinuses, perisinus, soft tissues, look at what happens in the orbit, intracranial compartment, skull base, and then some isolated non-sinonasal sites where we have seen that mucor has been catching these particular sites. And at the end, I'll just like to complete with a couple of slides on the issues that we have faced in this storm, as you have very rightly called it, in the last 1.5 months or so. So as far as imaging goes, let's jump in straight away. What I use is the 7-point module to assess the scan immediately. So these 7 points, it's a very, very good article in the AJNR. If you have two or more of these points positive, it gives you a very high specificity and PPV. So we're not going to the numbers here, but it just tells you that if you look at these areas, the nasal soft tissue, septal, turbinate ulceration, and necrosis, periantral fat stranding, retroantral and premaxillary. So you look anterior and posterior to the sinus. Look for bone dehiscence, look for orbit invasion, pterygopalatine fossa, nasolacrimal duct, and lacrimal sac. So a quick review of these, and the best part of this module is that it is possible on non-contrast CT. That is the beauty of this model. Then, of course, if you can move on to the MRI, and everybody is very well aware of the black turbinate sign and now extended to the black mucosa sign, where it's devitalization of the sinonasal mucosa by the mycotic vascular invasion. And of course, the nature of the secretions giving rise to certain kind of appearances on CT, like a CT hyper would be because of the calcium, magnesium, zinc, and the MRT2 hypo would be due to manganese and iron. But actually, as of the acute phase, I have really not found this to be of much significance. I would rather concentrate on the first 2 points. So let's come to CT. I think we should consider CT as the first modality of choice in early cases. When you are just, you know, we are getting a lot of cases to rule out mycor, COVID, some 2-3 weeks back, steroids, diabetes, the typical profile. And why do we do that? Because very early on, if you just do your windowing properly in the soft tissue window, not in the PNS or the bone window, you should look at these perisinus spaces. That's your premaxillary space. That's your retroantral space here. That's the normal clean fat that you should be seeing in these spaces. And why are these spaces so important? These are the spaces that are connecting directly to the pterygopalatine fossa, pterygomaxillary fissure, masticator space, infratemporal fossa. So the disease, if once it gets into these spaces, is going to travel very quickly outside the sinuses. As I mentioned earlier, the good part about the 7-point module is that it is a non-contrast study. If you are giving contrast, you think there is some complication, then we have to go ahead and comment on the orbital and the intracranial part. Why I would not suggest the MRI in the early stages is because MRI, when you give a contrast, it generally sometimes tends to overestimate the pathology, and then we start jumping to conclusions. So let's look at the first sign, nasal soft tissue, septal orbit turbinate ulceration and necrosis. I have seen this, from my experience in the last 1.5 months, if we look at something like this on a CT, that's a septal ulceration there. Can you see that very irregular part of the septal mucosa there? And a necrotic area in between the middle turbinate and the inferior turbinate in that soft tissue. And that is a focal soft tissue loss there. This is how you will see it on CT. And this patient turned out to be mucor positive from the histopath. Same kind of stuff you can see on MRI. So on MRI, you can look at the turbinate on this side, and you look at this turbinate on the other side. This is a non-contrast stir image or a kind of an inversion recovery sequence, where you will see that this turbinate is getting necrosed. It's not bringing that signal that we are having here. And on contrast, you're seeing completely the vertical lamella is necrosed, and that anterior part of the middle turbinate where they say the disease generally starts, that part is necrosed. So from my experience, I would like to just make this one point that this is one of the earliest signs that we have been seeing, which we're going to say that, yes, please go ahead with the endoscopy and maybe the crust, et cetera, and go ahead and try and confirm whether this is mucoid. The second thing is the retroandral, the retroandral and the premaxillary fat stranding. Now, if you are looking for bone dehiscence, you will go to the bone windows. And we know that the fungal elements are going to go along the vascular channels. And that will produce this kind of bone dehiscence, which you might not see if you put it on your soft tissue windows. So it's important to look for these bony dehiscences there. And the other thing we know is that when we look at certain premaxillary soft tissues and we find soft tissue there, that can be either due to vascular congestion or actual direct infiltrates by fungal elements. And we know that this disease in the sinus can spread through seemingly intact bones because the fungus is going to get transmitted through the vascular channels. So the retroantral and the premaxillary fat stranding can take place even with the intact bone. The fourth point is the orbital invasion. And how can this happen? It can happen through two ways. Either it can happen through the floor of the sinus here, that is via the canal for the infraorbital nerve, as you're seeing here, that this there is a dehiscence there of the canal, there is an enhancement of the infraorbital nerve, the disease has spread to the orbit, the inferior rectus muscle is enlarged and it's bulky. Same case, we just come out a bit and we see that there is again a break there in the floor of the orbit, and that's the bulky inferior rectus muscle, and that is orbital extension of the pathology from the maxillary sinus. At the same time, we also saw that there was a break in the floor of the maxillary sinus. In such patients, we instantly just distend the cavity with oral contrast, and we can demonstrate that there is a oroantral fistula too, which is also known in these fungal conditions. The other way that you can go into the orbit is through the medial wall. So here we are seeing typically that it is through the floor on the right side. This is another case. On the right side, you're going through the floor of the sinus, but on the left side, your big break in the maxillary, in the lamina papyracea there, and the ethmoid disease is seen extending into the orbit on the left side. And that's the medial rectus muscle, that fat plane, which we normally should see very well, that is obliterated. Now, this is a very gross disease. This is really gross, and we can pick this up quite easily on CT. MR comes into play when you're suspecting early orbital invasion, early intracranial problems, and see how MR brings out that, that particular finding. That black line represents the periosteal interface of the lamina papyracea, and there you can see that it is defective, and that is a very early intraorbital extension of that enhancement from the ethmoid sinus into the medial intraorbital compartment. And that again, you can see there, the lamina papyracea is deficient, and that's your very early intraorbital extension. Coming to the pterygopalatine fossa. Now this again can be very well seen just on plain CT because the pterygopalatine fossa contains fat. Now all head neck people know that fat is your friend. Wherever there is normal fat, you know that there is no problem. The moment the fat gets obliterated there, this, of course, is slightly more advanced because there is a destruction of the posterior border of the maxillary sinus, a widening of the PPF there, and that is typically how the disease will spread from the pterygopalatine fossa into the pterygomaxillary fissure. The other reason why you need to see this particular area is because of disease in the nasal cavity here. The sphenopalatine foramen, which transmits the branches of the posterior and superior nasal nerves, the fungus also catches arteries, but it also catches the nerves. So the transmission of disease can occur via the sphenopalatine foramen into the pterygopalatine foramen through the pterygomaxillary fissure into the infratemporal fossa. Now again here, subtle, if you want to see the subtle changes, MR is the modality for you. So here you can see that there is a normal fat in the pterygopalatine fossa on the left side. That hypo-intense stuff is fat. And here you can see that there is an enhancement in this PPF. And here, of course, there's enhancement here in the nasal cavity. And of course, enhancement going into the retroantral fat and also into the infratemporal fossa. The other thing is lot of people also are coming now with watering of the eyes. So a lot of these patients are presenting with watering of the eyes. And if you see here, this is the normal nasolacrimal duct on the left side. And look at the nasolacrimal duct on the right side. So that's enhancing soft tissue in the nasolacrimal duct. That is involvement of the lacrimal sac on the same side. And that is early extension of the disease that we were seeing here on the coronal view into the opening of the nasolacrimal duct. And this, of course, is extensive soft tissue loss in the area of the septum and the nasal cavity. So these 7 points really are quick to pick up, can be seen on a plain CT scan of the paranasal sinuses. And so you can triage these patients very quickly. Moving on to MR. Now, MR you would do when you are suspecting something very specific. But if you're just routinely doing an MR, you can pick up something like this. And this is called what we've been picking up as the black mucosa sign or the black turbinate sign. Now, normally, if you see here, the septal mucosa should enhance just like this. And when it doesn't enhance, you get a black mucosa sign. And this part of the turbinate that you see here should be enhancing like this. And that doesn't enhance. And that gives you the black turbinate sign. So that has been now, it's been almost 10 years since the first paper came out. And a lot of people have been talking continuously about this particular sign on MRI. So a subtle sign is the black mucosa sign and the black mucosa lining sign. And a really advanced sign would be a complete break in the mucosa like this. So if you can see in the nasal cavity, this entire side looks darker than the left side. It is not enhancing as much. This is all under perfused tissue here. Not only that, you see a big break here in the mucosal lining in the maxillary sinus. That's definitely necrotic SCR. And not only that, it has come out into the perisinus soft tissues, into the masticator space, into the infratemporal fossa, and there is extensive involvement of the neck spaces on the right side. Another case where not only is the lining eroded, but there is extensive necrosis also going almost up to the bone. So here you can see that the mucosa is pretty much intact. It starts getting denuded here. And in this case, almost reaches the cortical margin of the bone. And also you can see that the premaxillary fat also is involved because even though the bone is intact, there's going to be spread of disease through that seemingly intact bone. Now, it's again very easy to jump into things. So then you always have the second point of view. And this paper came out in 2019, and I think it was a very sensible paper that not all black turbinate signs are mucor or are angioinvasive pathology. They have given a whole list of findings that can differentiate between a black turbinate and a black mucosa sign on invasive fungal versus something that we normally see in a immunocompetent patient. So we will typically see this kind of striations. We will see this punctate kind of non-enhancing foci, you will see these lines, and typically the posterior parts will be more kind of apparent in an immunocompetent patient versus a patient with acute invasive fungal. This mucosal lining also will be intact. So one has to be very careful that don't overcall something that a turbinate does that doesn't enhance or a mucosal lining that doesn't enhance. It's not always angioinvasive stuff. I will just have one slide here that what it does. So we from the orbit, we move on to now the intracranial part, what all it can catch also other than the sinuses and the orbit. And a flare sequence like this, we do a 3D flare sequence, is very good to pick up a signal in the optic nerve. And that's your optic nerve, which is kind of brighter than the other side. And that's optic neuritis. Then of course, we know that it can move ahead and from the orbital apex and involve the cavernous sinus. That's a cavernous sinus thrombosis there. And once it enters the cavernous sinus, it can catch the cavernous segment of the internal carotid artery. And if you compare on both sides, you can make out that this artery is normal, but this has got intimal thickening and enhancement, and that's going to prone to be throwing infarcts in the future. We have also seen in the last 1.5 months, meningitis, subdural empyemas, cerebritis, cerebral abscesses, subarachnoid hemorrhage, cortical venous thrombosis, because again of the angioinvasive kind of pathology that we see, leading to venous infarcts, and of course the cranial nerve involvement. So the last couple of slides that I'd just like to finish off is, we've been seeing certain kind of patterns that do not fit into what we've been taught in the past. So sometimes, of course, here there is disease in the sinus, but we are now seeing that maybe the nasal cavity sinuses are pretty clear, but there is a lot of disease happening in the orbital apex. And that we are probably going to correlate it with disease in the posterior ethmoids and the high incidence of onodes that we see in our population. So that is probably one point that we are seeing. Second thing we are seeing is osteonecrosis. So we are seeing devitalized bone, sometimes in an isolated site like the palate here. So this, if you see something like this, completely black bone, which does not enhance on contrast, though the soft tissue around it enhances, this is devitalized bone. And if you do a CT, you will get these typical air loculi within a permeative osteolysis, something like we are all very, very used to seeing in osteoradionecrosis. We've been seeing a lot of osteonecrosis in our patients of Mucor. Again, you can get skull-based osteomyelitis in non-Mucor. So typically, again, a devitalized bone. This was a case which was post-operative status for Mucor, came back for a follow-up, and this again is devitalized bone. Again, you see those scattered air loculi surrounded by inflammatory tissue and meningeal thickening. So again, devitalized bone in a case of Mucor mycosis, osteoradionecrosis. Sometimes you can just get it as an unrelated manifestation. This patient was not COVID positive, did not give history of COVID in the last 3 months, but there was extensive involvement of the skull base. And we can extrapolate those findings that we saw earlier here. And then we looked up the literature and we found that there is something called as an indolent Mucor, which can stay for 3 to 4 months. And we just raised that possibility. We haven't got a histopath on this as yet, but something like this, now we have a high index of suspicion for Mucor mycosis. Also, we have seen that sometimes typical findings, histopath, there is no fungus, sometimes non-specific findings, and in histopath, you have fungus. So this has been our experience in the last 1.5 years or so. So in conclusion, what I would like to say is, because of this storm that we have experienced, our interpretation of scans should be situational. We need to know the background very, very clearly. We need to be talking, the clinicians and the radiologists need to be talking as to what we are going to do, how we are going to report these scans. The learning is experiential for me. I'm learning every day with the new things that I'm seeing on so many scans. If you are diagnosing Mucor confidently on imaging, we have missed the bus. I think we are already too late. We have to pick up those early signs. Early imaging is necessary to put up those red flags and to tell our clinical colleagues that please move a little bit more aggressively on these patients in that particular clinical setting. The point also I want to make here is, because we are now getting the post-operative scans for re-evaluation, imaging really cannot differentiate between active residual disease and post-operative reactionary mucosa after debridement. We really cannot tell you too much there. I'm trying to look into diffusion and ADC imaging, but that's going to take a little while. And finally, I'd like to just end with a sentence with my folded hands to all my clinical colleagues. We are radiologists. We are not microbiologists. We are not pathologists. We are experiencing pressure as well, you know, whether this is Mucor, not Mucor, and we are trying to do our best to help you. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Sanjay, for an absolutely fantastic presentation, comprehensive and yet very concise. We do have a lot of questions for you, but Sanjay is going to join us for the interactive session after the talks. So I think we'll do all the questions together. For everyone who does have questions to ask, it would be easier if you can give it to us in writing in your chat box, so that if we have repetition, we don't waste time. Thank you again, Sanjay. We're now going to come to our second talk of the evening, which is by Dr. Amit Dravid. He's an infectious disease specialist, having passed his MD from Sion Hospital in Mumbai. He has now got more than 12 years of experience in dealing with infectious diseases. And really, we could not think, because, you know, it was centered around Pune, so we couldn't think of a better person to sort of talk to us through COVID, through Mucor, especially. And what is now the recommended treatment protocols, the regimes, if something's not available, what do we do? Is there any prophylaxis? What is the long-term management? We will ask Amit to give us his views on this. Over to you, Amit.
Thank you. I would like the organizers to upload my presentation, please. Can you upload the first slide, please? So thank you for inviting me for this webinar. And last 1 year has been really tough for infectious disease consultants like me. And we thought that the COVID wave is going down and hopefully we will have some respite, but no. COVID has now led to more complications, and now we are having an epidemic of mucormycosis, which we have to manage in our wards. And thanks to Danish for involving me as well, because we together have ended up seeing lots and lots of mucormycosis cases in the recent past. Next slide. So the mucormycosis involves a family of fungi, which, please go back. So the mucormycosis involves a family of fungi, which includes Rhizopus, Mucor, Cunningamella, Rhizomucor, Apophysomyces, and Succinia. And we are going to concentrate only about the rhino-orbitocerebral part, because that is what is the commonest presentation of mucormycosis we are seeing in post-COVID patients. Although pulmonary, gastrointestinal, cutaneous, renal, and disseminated zygomycosis is also known. So this is a fungus which is known for its angioinvasion. It's known for its dissemination. It's known for its perineural invasion, because of which, although we are mainly concentrating on rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis, it can also disseminate. And I'm sure that very soon we will have disseminated zygomycosis been reported from all over India. The problem with this fungus is it has a very high mortality. The mortality is anywhere between 25 to maybe 80%. On an average, it's around 50%. So we really need to do a better job of managing and treating all those storm of mucormycosis patients, which we are going to get in our practice. Next slide. So the question arises that why there is suddenly a storm? Dr. Ved already said that we are getting a storm of mucormycosis patients. So majority of the patients which we are seeing are having diabetes mellitus and also having ketoacidosis. That is the first risk factor which is leading to mucormycosis. Secondly, it is now been known that COVID per se also leads to lymphopenia, depletion of CD4 and CD8 counts, just like HIV, because of which it is leading to immune suppression, and that is leading to opportunistic mucor infections. And thirdly, use of glucocorticoids and tocilizumab. So we are using glucocorticoids for all patients who are needing oxygen. We are using tocilizumab for patients who are going into cytokine storm. And these immunomodulators are also leading to change in the nasal mucosa environment, because of which mucor can enter and then disseminate, leading to rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. What we have observed in these last few months is that majority of the mucor cases which we are getting are in patients who had been treated for mild COVID, and they were prescribed steroids for mild COVID, which is an actual absolute no-no. So majority of our patients, almost 60-70% of patients, actually did not need steroids, but were still prescribed steroids even in home isolation, or sometimes even in hospitals when they were not even given oxygen. So the role of steroids in COVID is only for patients who require oxygen, or only for patients who are having moderate to severe disease, because of which if you prescribe steroids in patients with mild disease or in patients who do not need oxygen, then this is the complication which we are going to encounter. So people ask me why suddenly this mucor surge. I always tell them, look at the OPD prescription of home quarantine patients, or look at the prescription of patients with mild COVID disease. If you find steroids, especially strong steroids like oral Medrol, oral Dexona, oral Omnipotyl, that is the main reason which is triggering so much mucormycosis in our patients. Next slide. So what it is doing is it is just stunning the cilia of the nasal mucosa, because of which the rhizopus, which is the commonest mucor which is there, cannot be eliminated, and it enters the sinuses and causes this dreaded disease. The mucor can be easily identified on histopath because it is broad, it is a septate, and it has irregular branching. So it can be easily differentiated. Experienced pathologist and an experienced microbiologist can easily differentiate mucor from aspergillus, which is another risk factor for causing sinusitis. So as of now, we are dealing with an epidemic of mucor, and many times the histopath report says it looks like aspergillus. I always tell them, take a second opinion with the pathologist. If the pathologist says it is broad, a septate, or irregularly branched hyphae, then it is most likely mucor, it is not aspergillus. Plus, mucor also has characteristic features which have been already mentioned. One is angioinvasion, second is tissue infarct, third is perineural invasion, and fourth is dissemination. So if that is there, then it is very, very likely to be mucor mycosis. Next slide. Next slide. Some of this will be repetition, which has already been told by Dr. Ved in his lecture. Next slide. Most common, as I said, rhino-orbito cerebral mucor mycosis. Most common, black HR on the palate. Next slide. Patient coming to you with proptosis, patient coming to you with sinus pain, patient coming to you with thickening of the skin over the face, and when you examine, he is just recovered from his COVID treatment. Majority of the patients are saying that just 15 days back, my COVID treatment was over, and then I started developing this facial pain, this ear pain, and then when we investigate with a CT, PNS, or an MRI brain, we get to mucor mycosis. Next slide. As I've already said, we use the calcophore strain, all the blancophore stain for the clinical or microbiological specimens, and we see a septate hyphae, irregular ribbon-like appearance, wide-angle branching, prominent infarcts, angioinvasion, and perineural invasion. Majority of the people don't have blood biomarkers positive in their blood. So if you have mucor mycosis, then your galactomannan is most likely negative. If you have mucor mycosis, your 1,3-beta-D-glucan in blood is also negative. So these biomarkers are negative in mucor mycosis. And it is another way of differentiating mucor mycosis from aspergillus, because aspergillus has a positive galactomannan, while mucor mycosis has most likely has a negative galactomannan. So negative biomarkers, a CTPNS which shows fungal sinusitis, and a histopath which shows irregular ribbon-like wide-angle a septate branching hyphae, very, very classical mucor mycosis. Do we need genus and species sequencing to identify? I don't think so, because any mucor which causes infection in the sinus can be treated with whatever treatment regimens we have as of now. Next slide. These are just the histopath slides. Next slide. You can see a septate branching wide-angle hyphae. Next slide. And this is the differentiation between aspergillus and mucor. Right side, a septate hyphae, wide-angle branching. While left side, it's the aspergillus, it is septate hyphae with narrow angle branching. So an experienced pathologist and experienced microbiologist can easily tell you whether this is aspergillus sinusitis or mucor sinusitis. Thankfully, as of now, we don't have that dilemma to sort out. Whatever storm we are getting is about mucor mycosis of the sinuses. Next slide. So I've already said majority of the treatment is surgical. 90% of the work has to be done by a team of ENT surgeons, plastic surgeons, and neurosurgeons. Functional endoscopic sinus surgery, which Danish will definitely talk about in his talk, is the mainstay of treatment. The better you are at surgical debridement, the better you are at surgical debulking, that makes the physician's job much, much easier. Why is it so? Because this necrotic HR or necrotic tissue, which is there in the sinuses or on the turbinates, my antifungals will not reach in the necrosed tissue. So if the ENT surgeon or if the surgeon doesn't remove the black HR, doesn't debulk all the necrotic material from the sinuses, my antifungals, that is liposomal amphotericin B, all triazoles like posaconazole or ivasuconazole are not going to work. So the mainstay of treatment is surgery, either FES or enucleation or both, depending upon what the surgeon decides. The medical treatment comes after the surgery, so the surgery always is primary. Next slide. What are the antifungal drugs? As I said, early antifungal therapy definitely improves outcomes of mucormycosis. There was a study which had said that if you delay amphotericin B therapy for more than 6 days after diagnosis, then your mortality almost doubles. From 50%, it goes up to 83%. So many of the times, we start liposomal amphotericin B as soon as the radiologist tells us that this looks like fungal sinusitis. Maybe he's posted for functional endoscopic sinus surgery next day, but we don't waste time. Immediately we put the patient on liposomal amphotericin B. See the dose. The dose of liposomal amphotericin B is slightly higher. Normally, we use the dose of liposomal amphotericin B at 3 mg per kg, but in mucormycosis, the dose is 5 mg per kg. So from 5 to 10 mg per kg, depending upon where the mucor is the standard dose. Liposomal amphotericin B is the mainstay of therapy and should be started immediately on suspicion till the functional endoscopic sinus surgery is done and the histopath report is awaited. It can take 2 to 3 days. In that, you can waste precious amount of time and can define the mortality rate at your institute. So start liposomal ampho B immediately. If CNS involvement is suspected, then you have to increase the dose from 5 mg per kg per day to 10 mg per kg per day. So for rhino-orbital mucormycosis, the dose is 5 mg per kg per day. If the CNS is involved, the dose has to increase to 10 mg per kg per day. And remember, you have to start the full dose on day one. It should not be that you start 50 mg today, then 100 mg tomorrow, then 200 mg day after tomorrow, and then finally you reach your dose of 300 mg or say 400 mg, whatever is the dose on day 4 or 5. If the patient is 60 kg, the dose is 300 mg, then 300 mg should be started on day one and it should be continued. I'll tell you the duration in my next slide. If liposomal amphotericin B is not available, can we use another lipid variation of amphotericin B? Yes, there is another product that is amphotericin B lipid complex. That can also be used at the same dose of 5 mg per kg, just like liposomal amphotericin B, if liposomal amphotericin B is short or is not available. So amphotericin B lipid complex can be used, but only if CNS involvement is not there. So for rhino orbital thing, amphotericin B lipid complex can be easily used. Many people then ask me, sir, liposomal amphotericin B is not there, amphotericin B lipid complex is not there. Can I use conventional amphotericin B or amphotericin B deoxycholate? Amphotericin B deoxycholate has been used for almost 20 to 30 years for mucormycosis, but as of now, the use is discouraged. Why? Because amphotericin B deoxycholate can be given in maximum dose of 1 mg per kg per day, while liposomal amphotericin B and amphotericin B lipid complex can be given at the dose of 5 mg per kg per day. So automatically you are delivering a higher dose of amphotericin B at the site, plus the concentration of amphotericin B in the sinuses is much, much higher for liposomal amphotericin B or amphotericin B lipid complex as compared to conventional amphotericin B. Thirdly, amphotericin B, conventional amphotericin B has very, very high side effects like thromboplebitis, like nephrotoxicity, like bone marrow toxicity with anemia, neutropenia, liver toxicity like hepatitis, hypokalemia, renal tubular acidosis. All these are side effects of conventional amphotericin B or amphotericin B deoxycholate and can be seen in around 50 to 60% of patients, while the same toxicity of liposomal amphotericin B comes down to less than 10%. So it's a better drug and should be given preference whenever possible. Many people ask me whether caspofungin or echinocanidins can be used. I tell them very clearly that in vitro activity, there is no in vitro activity of caspofungin against mucormycosis. Please don't use it. Then people ask me whether we can combine these two things. As you know, liposomal amphotericin B works against mucor. Then there are triazoles like posaconazole and isavuconazole, which I'll talk about in my next slide, whether they are also active against mucor. Many people ask me whether we can combine it. I'll tell you where it can be combined in my next slides. Next slide. So, as I said, amphotericin B deoxycholate should be discouraged. But as of now, there is a situation where amphotericin B lipid complex and liposomal amphotericin B is completely short. In that case, I tell patients, okay, fine, you can buy amphotericin B deoxycholate, start it at 1 mg per kg per day, look very, very rigorously for side effects like thrombophlebitis, kidney toxicity, renal tubular acidosis, hypokalemia, and try to give it as long as possible, waiting for liposomal amphotericin B to come back into the market. Next slide. What about triazoles? They have really revolutionized treatment of mucormycosis now in the private sector. There are two triazoles which are available, isavuconazole and posaconazole. As I said, isavuconazole is a broad spectrum triazole. It has similar activity to amphotericin B. And there was a trial which was conducted where isavuconazole IV was used for patients with mucormycosis, and the results were compared with the fungiscope registry where liposomal amphotericin B was used. There they showed that giving IV isavuconazole upfront as first line therapy of mucormycosis led to survival in more than 60% of patients, equivalent to that of liposomal amphotericin B. So isavuconazole has now been accepted with moderate recommendation as first line therapy for mucormycosis. What about posaconazole? Initially, we had posaconazole oral suspension, because of which the oral absorption was very, very poor, and hence we could not lead to normal drug levels of posaconazole, because of which the drug levels were not reached and the mucor could not be suppressed. Now we have IV posaconazole, and also we have delayed release tablets. Both these achieve adequate drug levels in the blood, because of which drug levels are reached properly and the mucor can be suppressed. So posaconazole delayed release tablet and posaconazole IV is now available also as first line therapy for mucormycosis. Next slide. What about step down therapy? Once you have given liposomal amphotericin B and you have stabilized the condition, you have suppressed the mucor, and now you are very, very confident that you can step down from liposomal amphotericin B, you can step down to either oral posaconazole, or you can also step down to oral isavuconazole. So first line therapy always liposomal amphotericin B. If liposomal amphotericin B is not available, amphotericin B lipid complex. If that is not available, conventional amphotericin B deoxycholate if the patient is poor, or you can give an option of IV isavuconazole or IV or tablet posaconazole upfront as first line therapy. If you are giving liposomal amphotericin B and you have stabilized the disease, you can step down to either oral posaconazole or oral isavuconazole as step down therapy. Next slide. Next slide. So as I said, it has been shown that posaconazole reaches a minimum inhibitory concentration of fungi in almost 50 to 60% of patients. There is complete suppression. So first line treatment with isavuconazole or first line treatment even with posaconazole is useful in more than 60% of patients. Next slide. So these are the guidelines which were published just 1 year back about how to manage mucor, and I would really suggest everyone to have a look at them. Next slide. And they are very clear. First, liposomal amphotericin B, 5 mg per kg per day. If CNS involvement is there, increase it to 10 mg per kg per day. If the disease is suppressed, you are very, very confident that you have controlled the disease. You can go to oral step down therapy to either oral posaconazole or oral isavuconazole. However, if there is renal failure, the patient has a creat of say baseline creat of 2.5 or 3, you can upfront start with isavuconazole or posaconazole because they are nephrosafe drugs and they can also suppress the mucor per se even without the help of liposomal amphotericin B. Next slide. What should be the duration of therapy? This is a really controversial topic and nobody knows the real answer. Many, many guidelines say that you might have to continue liposomal amphotericin B till you are sure that the immunosuppression is reversed, the sugar is controlled, the ketoacidosis is reversed, and there is either substantial or complete response on imaging, which you know is very, very difficult because of scarring or post-operative changes. So many people say that if the physician and the ENT surgeon and the neurologist, neurosurgeon is confident that he has debulked majority of the mucor, the treatment the patient is taking has completely stabilized the disease, then he can be discharged on step-down therapy with oral posaconazole and can be sent home. The oral posaconazole or oral isavuconazole therapy can be continued in multiple case reports for up to 3 to 6 months as well. So once you debulk majority of the mucor, once you start liposomal amphotericin B and you have achieved majority control of the mucor in the sinuses, then you can take a decision after repeat endoscopy to step down to oral posaconazole, which can then be continued for almost 3 to 6 months. And we have had patients with very, very severe mucor, which had gone from the orbit right up to the brain, where we have continued posaconazole after local control of mucor for even up to 6 months, and patients have done well. So because of step-down therapy and switch to oral therapy, it has made our job much, much easier. We give liposomal amphotericin B for around 3 to 4 weeks, stabilize the mucor in the disease, stabilize the mucor, and then shift to oral step-down therapy. Next slide. What about salvage therapy? If liposomal amphotericin B doesn't work, that means after giving liposomal amphotericin B, still there is progression of mucor. Initially, it was in the sinus, then goes into the orbit, and sometimes also leads to a brain abscess. Then you have to then either involve combination therapy of liposomal amphotericin B plus posaconazole, or liposomal amphotericin B plus isavuconazole. Or if you have used posaconazole or isavuconazole upfront, you will have to shift to lipid formulations of amphotericin B. So one or the other you will have to shift to. This is where salvage therapy is where we use combination therapy, because we have to bring the mucor fast under control and the surgeon has to operate again to have the mucor back under control. Next slide. Salvage therapy recommendations are the same. If you have used liposomal amphotericin B, shift to isavuconazole or posaconazole, or use combination. If you are already using isavuconazole and the patient has progressed, shift to liposomal amphotericin B. Next slide. What about adjunctive treatment? Many people talk about amphotericin B local irrigations, but with such good liposomal amphotericin B or triazoles which are available, I don't think there is now a role of amphotericin B local irrigation after a very, very good debridement is done by the ENT surgeon. Similarly, there was talk about saline and betadine nasal washes to prevent mucormycosis. Again, the data is very poor, and betadine per se can cause weakening ciliary clearance, because of which the mucor can stay inside and also progress to sinusitis. So the data is still out. There is no clear-cut data to suggest that saline or betadine nasal washes can prevent mucor. Next slide. What about iron chelators? As you know, desferrioxamine was a high-risk factor for mucormycosis. Now there are new iron chelators like deferrisirox, which don't act like siderophores. And initially it was thought that deferrisirox added to amphotericin B might improve the treatment of mucor. But sadly, this study proved that adding deferrisirox actually worsened the mortality, and it increased the mortality from 20% to 80% in patients with mucormycosis. So as of now, only liposomal amphotericin B or combination of liposomal amphotericin B with a triazole, no addition of any iron chelating agent like deferrioxamine or deferrisirox to the treatment regimen. Next slide. Whether prompt control of sugars and ketoacidosis does help, it leads to reversal of immunosuppression and faster management. If the patient is neutropenic, sometimes we give GCSF to improve the neutropenia. Glucocorticoid treatment, as I have already said, giving glucocorticoid therapy to mild COVID cases on OPD basis is the biggest risk factor for mucor epidemic in India as of now. And if mucor develops, I would suggest tapering and omitting the steroid as fast as possible. So I don't use steroid for mild COVID disease, or if you have used it and the patient develops mucor, taper and omit it as fast as possible. What about hyperbaric oxygen? Again, it's an experimental therapy, but guidelines don't recommend using hyperbaric oxygen therapy for mucormycosis. Next slide. And in conclusion, as I have said, in the post-COVID epidemic, rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis is the most commonly seen variant. The treatment has to be aggressive surgical debridement. The surgeon has to be the leader of the show, while liposomal amphotericin B is the backbone treatment, which we give for about 3 to 4 weeks or as long as the patient can tolerate. And then we step down to posaconazole therapy. Posaconazole or isavuconazole can be used also as a salvage regimen if the patient develops amphotericin B toxicity or if the patient cannot tolerate amphotericin B or the disease progresses on amphotericin B, posaconazole or isavuconazole can be used as a salvage regimen also with reasonable success. There is no use of deferrixerox, no use of hyperbaric oxygen therapy. We should control the sugars, reverse the ketoacidosis, stop the steroids. And even after doing all this, we still feel that mucormycosis has an unacceptably high mortality rate. We are seeing almost a mortality rate of around 30 to 40% in our hospital as well, even after giving all this treatment. Next slide. Thank you. And I'll take whatever questions come my way.
Thank you so much, Dr. Amit, for an excellent overview on the treatment and management of mucor. We do request you to stay with us because we will address all questions at the end of the talks in the interactive session in a short time. So I request Dr. Danish, if he's ready. Now, can I have Dr. Danish? Yeah. So Dr. Danish is a very young, enterprising, talented and dynamic surgeon in Pune, practicing at the Ruby Hall. Through the whole of the COVID era, he was one of the few people who was constantly working and doing a lot of surgery, including skull-based surgery through COVID. And I think because of his fearlessness and his approach, he's now been asked to do a lot of cases and is being swamped with mucor patients. So Danish, if you can tell us about your experience and how you've managed it, what your patients have been like, how they've done, then it'll be nice. Over to you.
Good evening, everyone. It's such a pleasure to be among all of you with such a wonderful webinar going on. Am I audible, sir?
Yes. Okay. Yes, Danish, you're good.
I would like to share my screen, sir.
Vimlesh, can we let Dr. Danish share his screen? Do you have a green share screen at the bottom? Is it green?
Yes, sir, I pressed that. It's asking for preferences.
So it is up to sir only to share it.
What is it asking for?
Yes, sir. It's asking for this access.
Give it access. Maybe in the permissions, you've not done access.
So access is already given.
Yeah, 1 second. System preferences. I'm unable to click on the Zoom this to give access.
Maybe if somebody from the backend team can help with Danish. Danish, you want to sort it out and maybe I can go to Darshan, let him finish his short talk.
Sure, sir.
While
sure.
You sort it out.
Danish, sir, otherwise you can do one thing. You can mail me the slides if it's okay. And sure, I'll share it.
No, Vimlesh, it's a video. You'll not be able to mail.
Okay.
You just help him with how to share it.
I'll get it.
Dr. Darshan, is Darshan there? Darshan, can you put your video on, please?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Yeah. Is your talk ready?
Yes, sir, my talk is ready.
Okay. So again, Darshan has done his fellowship with us in Mumbai a few years ago, and then he's gone back to Surat and he's doing fantastic skull-based work. He's now already done over 150 pituitary surgeries. He's doing more complex skull-based surgeries. And like Danish, you know that Gujarat was pretty much the epicenter, the starting point of this mucor pandemic. and like everybody else, or like so many other surgeons in Gujarat, Darshan has been pretty much in the thick of it. So we just wanted his perspective of what is happening in Gujarat and how they have been managing to deal with it or cope with it. You're on, Darshan. You can share your screen.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, thank you. Thank you, Nishit, sir, for giving me this opportunity. My screen is visible?
Yes, visible.
Am I audible, sir? Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so the clinical pathology, the physiology, the disease we are treating since now years. This mucormycosis, what I feel is nothing new for an ENT or for a physician or anybody else. This is my opportunity why I am here, is to experience what I have seen so far. So normally, we are seeing this second season of the COVID. Now, what made me think among this time is even the first disease, we were booming the patients with the steroids, with all the possible medications on a trial and error basis because the COVID guidelines were not clear before. But what made this second season more prone for the patients for the developing of mucormycosis? So in this season, I operated my first case on 3rd of April. On 3rd of April, I operated my first case. And amongst those first cases which I operated, all were somewhat like this, that extensive involvement, orbital, the intracranial extension, like typical what in our routine practice we used to see in our early days or in the days before the COVID arrived. So gradually what started, like the patients were started being screened by the radiologist. So even the symptoms of the mild symptoms of the headache or eye pain or eye redness or eye swelling, they started sharing those screening those patients, which made us bring these patients among our OT table. So likewise, such scans, we being an ENT surgeon, we never operate such patients who are having a minor haziness in the maxilla or in the ethmoids and all. But gradually what we saw is these patients, which does not reflect at all that the headache is not justified by this much amount of sinuses. So gradually what happened, because of the complaint, we had to go in, we had to operate these patients. And what we found was fungus like this. This is a similar patient's intraoperative finding. This made us really think and to screen which patients we should operate and which patients we should not. So we made those criteria, like among the chest physicians, then among the intensivists, that whoever patients who are post-COVID. So even we have seen the patients who are 1.5 months or 2 months post-COVID presented with the complaint of headache, presented with such scans, even without the involvement of the orbit or any intracranial extension. We started screening those patients also for the surgery. And surprisingly, in a month of from 13th April to 14th May, I operated 65 patients. In the 65 patients, only 7 were turned out to be negative for the mucor. And 12 patients we rejected because of already the intracranial involvement. So this is such a huge number that 58 patients with the minimum disease, even they turned out to be positive for the mucormycosis. So that's why the criteria somehow in Gujarat, or maybe I can say amongst our team, is even to screen all the patients who are COVID or post-COVID having headache for a day or even 2 days headache. We screen them for the CT scan or directly for the MRI of the PNS. So according to us, the MRI is being more specific for finding out or to screen out the patients who are having this mucormycosis or any other sort of fungal infection. So MRI was really helpful on culture of these patients. Out of this 58, 7 patients were turned out to be an aspergillus and 51 patients, they had mucormycosis. So all are under the treatment. Of course, amongst these 15 patients, we lost during the treatment because of the intracranial extension and the morbidity of the drug toxicity and all. So gradually, this all started booming up in Gujarat as well as all over India, that cases are rising up like anything. So from one cases, which we used to see in maybe 6 months, being an ENT, that is a mucormycosis, to 50 cases in a month, that to only a single doctor. In Surat, we do have around 80 ENT surgeons. I just can't imagine how many patients are being treated and being operated for the mucormycosis at the moment. So I really doubt and I really have concern that how and why these cases are increasing like this, anything. And as it was expected, like in case of remdesivir or in case of tocilizumab, certainly we find sort of amphotericin. So now patients, so we feel really being sorry for sometimes because of operating the patients and then down not finding the drug. So all those patients we are operating, now there's no amphotericin for them. So that is again another concern for the patients who are being operated. So in my series, what I've seen from a single case in a day till 5 cases have operated in a day, and that's a really huge number and that should really raise a concern. And this really made us think that why these cases are increasing, immunocompromised status, sugar, increase in the sugar, the diabetic ketoacidosis, this is nothing new. But then why? So even in the first season of the COVID, the only line of treatment which were approved for the patients of COVID, was steroids to prevent them from developing lung fibrosis and inflammation and all. Then why we did not have this many numbers of cases in the first season of COVID? So this is our, in our routine discussion or what I have experienced so far, that in this second season, the commonest reason I found was these things. So lack of sterility, lack of hygienic measures. This is one of the hospital where I went to see the patient who was having a suspected mucor. So this humidifier was just next to this patient's cot and he was being oxygenated from the same humidifier. Now just see the condition of this humidifier. This humidifier is dry. Even there is no air inside. Now there's no water inside. Normally we should fill up this bottle with a saline or sterile water. But this bottle is empty and we can see the greenish dots inside. So according to me, one of the strongest reasons for this boom of this mucormycosis in this second peak of the COVID. So patients who are already compromised, immunocompromised, they are on steroids, tocilizumab or any other drugs, they are being aerosoled by this fungus which is already there in the air. Second, in the first season, we did not find too much of less availability of the oxygen, which made the patients to do this. So this is really a horrible and really a serious concern for us because the patients were being oxygenated on roads, in auto rickshaws. We have seen they are being given oxygen at home, and as the staff, the nursing staff, they were overworked. They didn't have any time to go and take care of the patients in the home where they were home isolation and there was just oxygen which were being given in the home. So according to me, all this definitely increases the risk of developing this fungal infection, which is already there in our surrounding air. Now, this will immediately, there's no wonder that why the cases are on the peak. It's basically what I find is this unhygienic measures, lack of oxygen, which made the patients, being treated at the home. And even in my series, what I found was 90% of the patients were from the periphery. So like we stay in Surat. So in Surat's periphery, there are too many small towns. So we do get too many patients from there having a complaint of headache or some eye swelling and intraorbital, intracranial complications already presented to us. So 90% of the patients, roughly, they were from the periphery. So all these patients who are being treated periphery. So we really have a doubt that how they were being treated there. And we should really take care of all these things for these cases to stop in future so that we can save this is really a horrible disease. First of all, the cost effectiveness. Second, the morbidity. Third, the availability of the injections. And as Amit sir said, that there's a very high mortality even amongst the patients being treated with the surgery, with the all the possible medical management, still the mortality is very high. So what I really feel is to take care of all these hygienic measures amongst the
patients. Can you conclude in 2 seconds? You go quicker?
Yes, sir. So I would definitely like to conclude over here that this disease, well, like I'm showing you one video, that this is one of my patients who has been operated. So there's just a history of 2 days of headache. There's no any long duration of history. And what I could see in an endoscopy was completely necrosed right nasal cavity and left sided partly necrosed cavity. And I had to go in and operate this patient. And there's a routine practice what we exercise in our patient as an extensive debridement possible for that. And then load this patients with the medical management as much as possible for them to be disease clear or disease free. Yeah, that's it, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Daishan. That was very enlightening to know the ground realities that you all are facing. And I'm sure this same thing is being echoed in various different states around India. So yes, it sir. Is very disturbing, very distressing. And let's hope that whoever is in concerned with these matters can get things organized so that we have less of these cases, or we're at least better able to deal with these situations.
Yes, sir.
If you can stop sharing, then we can go to Danish again.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Darshan.
Thank you very much, sir.
Danish, can you share screen now if it's possible?
Yes.
Okay, fantastic.
So once again, good evening, everyone. Without wasting much time, let's start off with the presentation. Where aggression means survival, this mucormycosis has definitely taught us something. Management shortcomings and awareness deficits. Sorry. We have seen this in an epidemic proportion, and this is something unseen before. The misuse of antifungal drugs, the false sense of security that they give to the general practitioners, the underestimated aggressiveness of the disease, the wait for a negative PCR report to operate upon, overburdened healthcare, unable to check the uncontrolled sugars, use of steroids and biological agents, the lack of beds, O2, and now even the lack of the antifungal drugs, all this war that we have been fighting all through. Lack of dedicated COVID OTs and standby ICUs in post-op COVID patients who already have a bad chest. Awareness about the no debridement, no survival rule in case of this disease, which needs to be spread from our side. So what are the surgeon's challenges? Operate at the earliest in spite of the COVID status to be able to perform an aggressive surgery in a high-risk COVID patient, to explain the aggressiveness to the patient's skins after their exhaustive tryst with COVID, and their choice to make is between a morbidity or expiry. Consequences of delay proportional to the morbidity. So more the delay, more the morbidity and even mortality. And the disease I've seen going from unilateral to a bilateral extensive spread within a couple of days. This has already been addressed before, the various pathways through which the disease may spread through the nose, to the orbit, to the palate, to the brain. And since it's a multi-specialty thing, we need a team to control. Everyone sees from his point of view. So we have been hearing news that without addressing the sinuses, the eyeball has been removed. Without addressing the eyeball, the sinuses have been cleared, and all this confusion because we have never faced so much of a load before. Coming to the surgical video, this will be the main surgical video which I'll be presenting. One of my patients with a lot of eschars, black eschars and necrotic debris, where an extensive debridement is required. as you can see, the septum is involved, the lateral wall, the whole skull base involved in the disease process. That's the uncinate. That's the opposite side involving the septum as well as the middle turbinate. Definitely by the first look of it, you would know that it needs a rigorous debridement. So here I've tried to expose the skull base and started debriding the removing the necrotic area. We obviously send them for the histopathology as well as the fungal stain and fungal culture. Here you can see the glimpse of the maxillary ostium. I'm getting rid of the inferior turbinate in order to get more access. The posterior part of this inferior turbinate here is involved and seen darkened, already devitalized. Further exposure, debridement of the medial wall of maxilla. You can see how much of the necrotic debris and pus is coming out from the middle, from the maxillary sinus. So the key is extensive debridement of whatever ischemic black necrotic tissue we are seeing here. Drilling right above the choana now and superiorly towards the sphenoid sinus, the posterior ethmoids. And as you can see, this dark bone behind is the vomer. That's the superior turbinate. So literally this disease has not left anything untouched from the left side. Is the left nasal cavity, opening the maxillary sinus here and having a look at the condition. And that is the, drilling at the sphenopalatine region, the pterygomaxillary fissure area, again showing black necrotic debris. So the key is to debride as soon as you see bleeding, so that there is some perfusion and the drug reaches the area. Now that I have denuded the orbit also on my right side, you can see unhealthy orbit. Again, this all tissue needs to be cleared. It's all necrotic debris going towards the infratemporal fossa. And I'm going to continue debriding all the way until the tissue shows some signs of bleeding. Now, once I open the orbit, that's the lamina papyracea being separated. You can see all the fungal debris and necrotic material, unhealthy fat tissue, which comes out. Really a severe involvement in this case. So all this tissue has to go because leaving any bit of it would lead to intracranial extension very easily through the orbital apex. So I continue the debridement of the unhealthy tissue on the medial wall of orbit. Now that's again addressing the floor of the orbit where there was a small extension. And here at a point, I would like to reach where the sphenopalatine starts to bleed. Just removing the necrotic tissue, the fungal debris from the inferior wall of orbit or the roof of the maxillary sinus. Now, as you can see now, I can find some healthy bleeding in the area. I'm going to cauterize the sphenopalatine. So as much as possible, we try to clear the area. There's a prolapsed orbital contents into the nasal cavity. Now addressing the septum. As the anterior-ethmoidal artery we see. A glimpse of the sphenoid sinus. It's showing relatively healthy mucosa with some pus discharge at the floor, which eventually I washed out. Now, addressing the septum on the opposite side, you can see the septal bone already showing osteomyelitic changes, the inferior turbinate and the septal flap being debrided here. And so there's a septotomy already that has happened. I continue my debridement from the right side till the point again the mucosa starts showing some signs of bleeding. Now there's the rostrum or the keel of the sphenoid. It's already showing dark changes, so probably it's osteomyelitic bone again, which we need to get rid of. As you can see all around, the mucosa shows signs of bleeding. That means we have reached at some limit of debridement. So removing the vomer and the rostrum of the sphenoid. This is removing the affected part of the septum. So we will have a good glimpse of both the sphenoid sinuses here. The opposite side maxilla needs to be checked. Removing the bulla. Widening the ostium on the right side. Now I'd like to do the osteotomy of this the keel or the rostrum, because if you see that nature of the bone, it's looking absolutely dead. And inside the sphenoid sinus, again, I would say it's grossly healthy tissue with just some purulent discharge there. And I here remove the rostrum. There's the view inside the maxillary sinus. And on the left side, you see some unhealthy mucosa. And this is post debridement, 360 degree view of the maxillary sinus of the left side. And now towards the frontal sinus. That's a view of the frontal sinus, and he seems to be unaffected. And don't forget to check the palate after every as a part of every surgery. Now there have been, like, this was a typical case of mucor, but there have been some cases where there was a mixed infection which we would have easily mistaken as a bacterial sinusitis, but ultimately the patients land into this condition, which is the alveolar osteomyelitis. And here we end up, they develop the sinuses and the pus discharge from the alveolus, and we end up removing the maxilla, part of maxilla which is affected. And this was the intra picture of the same patient whose maxilla was removed, looking like a bacterial sinusitis, but ultimately developed osteomyelitis of the maxilla, and confirmed fungal elements. So it could be a mixed infection as well. Now, here was a patient, an interesting case where there was a lateral rectus palsy here. But if we see his video, if you see the nasal endoscopy, probably in a preliminary examination, you will not see much on an OPD basis. But once you go above, the focus of the disease was absolutely stuck to the orbit, going towards the cribriform and involving the upper part of the septum. That was the cribriform plate, which is dangling above. I cannot remove that in the same sitting and threaten the meningitis and a CSF leak at this stage of active disease. This is debriding the orbit medially and showing the fungal debris. Now, the challenge with this patient was that he still had vision. The patient did not complain of lack of vision in spite of so much of an extension of disease into the orbit. Except for the lateral rectus palsy, he has no other complaint from the eye point of view. And it's a dilemma whether to counsel the patient to lose his eye or whether to keep him in a strict surveillance, as of now still admitted. And we are keeping a tight look at the orbit. If it's showing any signs of infectivity further, we may have to take a call on the excentration. See the amount of pus coming when you press the eyeball. This is another patient where you can see the disease from the middle meatus side. The posterior part of the turbinate involved, the inferior turbinate cut, that gives us a good access and a visibility of the extent of disease. That's his maxilla. Now here I would like to mention that a day before scan of this patient showed disease only in the ethmoid sinuses. And once we took him on table, it had already gone to the palate. Here I'm doing a modified Denker's to see the maxillary sinus throughout, and I have cleared the disease from the sinus. There's a little mucosa remaining there, which I will eventually clean and see his palate. This is the condition. That's why we say it's so aggressive, it's so unpredictable. We can't really predict. I mean, we cannot delay the debridements for sure. For this reason, it spreads so fast. It has involved, at least 40%, 30 to 40% of his palate. And the bone above is black. It is, when I complete my debridement, you see, it's a completely osteomyelitic bone. Eventually, the patient had to get rid of that part of bone, obviously. So the figure so far, 35 cases in past 1 month, approximately, and still going on, 3 mortalities within a week post-op due to high CT score, sepsis, CR arrest, cardiorespiratory arrest. 3 lost in transit due to lack of hospital facilities, bed availability. 5 underwent maxillectomy or alveolectomy. 90% of the cases had at least one of the ophthalmic symptom. Every case had raised blood sugar level. 5 cases turned out to be bacterial sinusitis with osteomyelitis with orbital complication. Well, these days we have been noticing that in patients, some patients, we just find the fungal ball bilateral, which is turning to be invasive and presenting as an osteomyelitis of the maxilla. All of these were post-COVID patients. So we are also suspecting that other than the mucor, there might be, some fulminants of the fungal ball or the non-invasive fungus turning to be invasive and giving rise to this osteomyelitis of the bone. 5 cases orbit needed to be addressed further, and 4 cases operated were below 35 years, the youngest being 29 year old. Earliest operated at day 7 to day 8 of COVID, that was by me. All had been given steroids, so all had a strong history of diabetes and steroid post COVID. Now, the false alarms. Thromboembolic episodes causing ophthalmic symptoms and neuropalsies, multiple neuropalsies we had seen, but ultimately once we opened the sinuses and addressed for any suspicious areas, this turned out to be just inflammatory mucosa and came negative for the fungus. Post-COVID bacterial sinusitis, as already said, presenting with osteomyelitis and orbital complications, not turning out to be mucor. Again, I discussed about the fungal balls. How did they benefit from surgery? Yes, I would say the eye symptoms resolved on the next day or the day a day later. So even if we say that it's just sinusitis and patient is presenting with a complication, post surgery, definitely the prognosis obviously is better for the bacterial sinusitis leading to orbital complications. Just a thought process, the claim of mucor spreading via the O2 pipelines or humidification, in that case I would like to say that mucor is already present in the air, and if it is spreading through pipelines and humidification, then why not in the lungs? Why just it is seen in the nose, and why only unilateral to start with, and why only in the post-COVID patients? And this is just my thought, that nasopharynx is the hub of coronavirus. We need to have a lot of research into this less known topic. And is it the tissue ischemia that comes due to thromboembolism, and then the mucor becomes more fulminant? What comes first? Is it the mucor invading a healthy tissue, or is it the ischemia on which secondarily the mucor becomes really aggressive? Mucor easily invading the already compromised mucosa? And does that also explain the multiple facial nerve palsies that we are facing? Otherwise, there is no explanation to why the patient lands up in ptosis when the disease is not there, and why the patient at times presents with a facial palsy. I think that's the end of the presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Danish, so much for this very nice talk covering the surgical aspects of mucor, and which really brings us now to the most important part, where we can have an interactive discussion about various aspects of mucor. So if you can stop your share, Danish.
I've done that.
So we are still seeing your screen. You'll have to stop share. So let me in the meantime introduce our other panel members. Apart from all the speakers, we also have Dr. Vivek Sasindran from Kerala, who's, I would like to say, young but also very experienced. He does run his own training program. He's now professor at a teaching hospital and is doing fantastic work. He's kept us entertained through the whole COVID period through some phenomenal videos on YouTube addressing various types of endoscopy. We also have Dr. Adit Gupta, who's an oculofacial plastic and reconstructive surgery. With the eye gaining so much prominence, we thought it would be incomplete without having an oculoplastic or an eye doctor involved in the discussions. We also have a real treat for us, because we have, far as I'm concerned, the father of endoscopy in India, someone whose work has touched every person involved with ENT indirectly or directly. And thank you so much, Dr. Kirtane, for joining us. And sir will help with the moderation along with me for the other panelists. And finally, we will also have on request Dr. Neelam Vaid, Dr. Sanjay Vaid's wife, on the panel, so that we can also take additional questions. Right. So if you can have the videos on of all the panelists, then we can start with a few questions. So first question was for Dr. Sanjay. Given the fact that MRI is not easily available outside main cities, and also there is a cost issue as well as time taken issue, would you then depend only on a CT plane or also contrast, given that contrast has its own issues on potentially patients involved with renal problems, with diabetes, and may require amphorby in future?
As I said in the lecture, Nishit, I would really, if you're going to do a screening for these very early cases, I would still go with CT. And in these cases, we stick to a plain CT. The MR or the contrast comes in when there are specific questions raised by the referring clinician and a specialist. The problem is now, Nishit, that we are getting referrals directly coming in from GPs, from alternative medicine, people practicing alternative medicine without being routed through a specialist. So, you know, in such cases, to go ahead and jump into an MRI with contrast, I really think it's like jumping the gun. So I would still stick with CT. The issue with CT is that we will have to do a serum creatinine and a GFR before we give contrast to all these patients. And we try and avoid contrast CT as much as possible.
So in areas where the MR is easily available, would you then combine a plain CT with an MR?
No, because it doesn't work out that way. If there is a specific issue that needs to be addressed, orbital, intracranial, nerve, then I would definitely go in with an MR with contrast. If it is just to see whether there is a perispinous disease, there's a sinus involved, a septal ulceration, a terminal ulceration, I think CT does a fantastic job. It's quick, it's fast, it's cheap, it's easily available.
The other question that Kavita Sachdev had is on MR and CT, what views do you want? I assume it would be all views, but for you.
Acquirence actual, and then we can just reconstruct every possible view. So that's not a problem.
And on MR, T1, T2, flare, etc.
So we have truncated our protocol in MR for this particular situation, because we obviously can't take that prolonged, patients can't lie down for that kind of time. So we have a very truncated protocol for orbit and PNS, which should get up in about 20 minutes, including the contrast sequence. And we stick to generally axial and caudal. That's it. We don't do anything more.
So you're the moderator.
Yeah, Nish, I just wanted to ask Sanjay that, you know, he touched upon it briefly. We're getting requests after we do debridement. When do you want to do a check, whether there is something still left or do you need to go in again? So at that time, when we just do a CT, you see a lot of mucosal edema. What would you suggest? What would be the duration after which you might get reasonable information? Would you ask CT, CT contrast, MRI? And the problem is many of these patients are already started on amphotericin and their creat levels are going up. So there again, giving contrast becomes a problem. So any comments on that?
Yes, sir. For post-treatment, post-surgery thing, I would always go for an MR, because MR has that capacity that even if you don't give contrast, you have something called diffusion-weighted imaging with your ADC maps, where you could kind of differentiate post-treatment changes versus residual disease, like how we do in head neck cancers. So I would most certainly go with an MRI for evaluating, and generally in the range of say four to 6 weeks.
6 weeks, that much. And creatinine levels, where is your cutoff for giving gadolinium for creatinine levels?
More than creatinine levels, sir, we do the calculate the GFR based on the formula. Okay. And anything less than 30, we don't do, sir.
Yeah. So, thanks. You know, in respect to this post-op management, Vivek, you can take this. We would see our patients every 5 days or 6 days, or how soon do you want to see after your initial debridement? And I think sir's question was also regarding that would you scan them before you retake them up into the OT, or just go straight with an endoscopy view?
With respect to follow-up, what we have been doing is we do a repeat endoscopy and cleaning probably 3 to 4 days after the surgery. And we take a look at the endoscopic findings and then take a call. Now, again, that is based on the symptomatic relief. We look into certain markers. Probably we monitor the ESR and the CRP values and see if there is a drop. Now, if these values tend to stay on the higher side, then probably that is when we suspect that probably there is something that we are leaving behind, or probably the disease is progressing. And the call for radiology is taken if clinically there is worsening of the patient's condition from the time we took him up for surgery. So it is not routinely that we go for imaging immediately. Otherwise, as Dr. Sanjay said, it's probably 4 to 6 weeks later.
Okay. Yeah, carry
on. Point, Nishit, just one point, that according to those European guidelines that I think Amit had put up, there they have said something, at least when I went through that paper, they said weekly CTs. I guess that's in like really the really advanced cases where you need to have a weekly, but I don't think anybody is doing, I'd like to know if anybody is doing weekly CTs.
I think it is important when mucor goes into areas which are difficult to see, like pterygopalatine, etc., where you've taken out some disease, but you're not sure if there's more progress or in the orbit. And so next time you want to really decide whether you want to do this under local just for inspection or take him under GA because you want to do more surgery.
Anishit, one more thing that comes to mind is, as Dr. Danish showed us classical pictures, but we are now seeing when we are getting into the sinuses that you don't get that typical black eschar in many cases. You just get a slight discoloration of the mucosa and you get a gush of pus coming, and I've sent that pus and it's saying it's not able to show fungus. Now you're in a bit of a quandary. Do I go and do a debridement extensively just on the basis of the radiological findings because the pus is not showing mucor? We send frozen section. Sometimes it may show necrotic areas but may not identify the fungus. So any of you have faced this situation and how do you go forward on this?
So I had a few cases like that where the mucosa looked hyperemic, discolored basically, and not typically the black eschars that we have. But then that showed fungus, and a few cases where, a couple of cases in fact, where there was just pus discharge in the maxillary sinus, just angry looking red mucosa. But then eventually two of them landed up into this maxillary osteomyelitis. We had seen the maxillary sinus very properly. And it was a puzzle for us also how quickly it was spreading downwards towards the alveoli. Later on, when we sent the specimen of maxilla for the fungal elements, they were seen there. But I think it's a mixed infection presenting as a bacterial as well as a fungal component. Like I showed one of my small clip where it was just frank bacterial pus coming from the sinus.
Yeah.
The question
is if you're clinically suspecting it is mucor, but you get a negative culture or a negative biopsy, do you then go back and take another biopsy? Do you keep under observation? Or Amit, maybe you can take this. Would you empirically start antifungal treatment?
How much of debridement would you do?
True. Neelam's managed to get in, so can... Oh, she's gone again.
Yeah, so can I just take that?
Yes, please.
So I had a similar experience on this where, we got an HP which was totally negative. We got two biopsies sent and they all said that it was negative for mucor. But when I have put in the clinically, I was convinced that this was mucor. And I finally spoke to the relatives and said, look, I'm going to go ahead because I'm going to go in for, we went in for a maxillectomy finally. And I'm so happy I did that because when we opened it up, the entire bone of the maxilla was totally necrotic. So going here forward, I think, yes, the histopath, the staining, it definitely helps us. But you have to look at the clinical signs. And the only thing that made me go ahead with this decision was that when I put in the nasal endoscope, the lateral wall of the maxilla definitely looked, pale to me. But when you looked at the mucosa per se, as Dr. Kirtane said, we are not seeing the eschars, we are not seeing the pale mucosa, we are actually seeing inflammatory tissue. And that does become a challenge.
Radiologically, you get a clue. So
So radiologically, all that we were seeing was exactly what, Sanjay said. We were seeing all this periantral stranding. And I kept talking to the pathologist that this is fitting into mucor. Yeah. But she looked at the frozen section. We sent a frozen section also. So we looked at frozen section. We looked at two HPs. And she said, no, this is not mucor. I operated him day before yesterday. And today I get a call saying, yes, the specimen shows mucor. So I think there are going to be these clinical dilemmas that we're going to face, and we're going to have to rely a lot on our clinical suspicion in these cases. And it was a big decision for me because the surgery that I was now going to do was an external approach. But I'm happy that, my decision was the right one.
So Amit, for you, if you have a negative culture, would you insist on a positive culture before you start amphoby?
No, if the, as madam has said, if there is clinical suspicion that this looks like mucor, I would prefer to start with liposomal amphotericin B. If I did not have liposomal amphotericin B with me, if I did not have posaconazole with me, if I did not have isavuconazole with me, if I did not have amphotericin B lipid complex with me.
Voice.
I was just stuck with the personal amphotericin B. There may be actually, but now the things are so good that it's a suspicion. I know that it takes maybe days to get to the final diagnosis. I would prefer giving the patient liposomal amphotericin.
In this kind of situation, is there any role for a local amphoby wash while you're waiting for a culture report instead of starting IV straight away?
Sir, actually, there is no such data to support this. So I would, and plus, this is a systemic disease. It's an angioinvasive fungus. So I don't know whether local amphotericin B might. IV amphotericin B might be a difference between life and death.
As I said. Local wash is no issue, but there are some people who talk about intraorbital injections, intraorbital into the lesion areas with amphotericin. Is there any evidence on that that really helps?
Doctor,
no, sir.
So, if I may add observations about amphotericin B in the orbit. First of all, I would like to highlight the point which Dr. Kirtane sir already mentioned. We have been doing, although we are secondary in the treatment of mucormycosis in the orbit, I have exenterated up to 10 to 12 orbits in the second wave as compared to maybe two or three after the first wave. What I have observed in two of my cases was people with extensive rhino-orbital disease. During exenteration, the exenteration goes very smoothly for us because it is all ischemic. The orbit is ischemic. So there's very little bleeding during exenteration in a mucormycosis case as opposed to a carcinoma. So when I was doing exenteration in two cases, what I noted was everything was pale, but in the medial orbit and especially around the optic nerve, there was a sudden gust of pus from one of the loculi. Now, when we sent this specimen for histopathology, again, the report came out to be negative. So maybe that is something to add to Dr. Kirtane's observation. Sometimes the biopsy might come out to be negative and we have to hinge ourselves on our clinical suspicion and go ahead and do it. Second thing which we are noticing is that I always presume that the orbital disease is secondary to ischemia and infarction as compared to a fungal load within the orbit itself. A lot of times we are called upon to do exenteration directly in these cases, but I believe that sometimes exenteration can be avoided in majority of these cases just by going on clinical signs and symptoms. Now, just to give a small example, whenever we see a patient of thyroid eye disease who has proptosis, he also has congestive features. They also have chemosis of the conjunctiva. Now, in thyroid eye disease, the pathophysiology is basically restriction of backflow and ischemia within the orbit. Now, orbit is a tight compartment as opposed to the sinuses. And any amount of backflow reduction within the orbit is going to cause congestion and chemosis in the early stages. So we have to differentiate these points from actual invasion of mucor within the orbit, which can be done clinico-radiologically. And secondly, coming to the second point about role of intraorbital amphotericin B, this therapy has been tried since 2017, there have been some papers from University of California in San Francisco, where a certain group of doctors have tried it on 40 patients who had rhino-orbital mucormycosis. It has been published as well, but there is no clear-cut clinical guideline. Right now, all of us are going through an immense pressure of managing these patients. So it is something which we are trying and shooting in the dark, maybe. I have had patients who have shown improvement in the disease after amphotericin B in the orbit, and I have had patients who have shown worsening as well. So there is no predictive factor as such as of now, but any patient who has a vision in his eye and there is an involvement of the orbit, we are always going ahead and giving retroorbital amphotericin B when the ENT surgeons are doing their FES surgery, because we don't want to exenterate before a good debridement has been done. So, exenteration should never be done in the first stage, according to me, unless the patient has extensive involvement and cavernous sinus involvement, and he's fit for GA as well. Secondly,
Bishop, just because we're talking about eccentration here, just one question. If it's a blind eye, suppose the vision is gone, then I think your decision might be a little easier. Yes. But sometimes you have a patient with some vision there. He's got ophthalmoplegia, probably ptosis, and fair amount of disease in the orbit. We've seen patients with a lot of disease in the orbit where the vision is still present. Correct. So if this is a situation where he's going to have a completely paralyzed eye, there's no movement, is he going to be able, this is the argument that's going on, is he able to use that eye, or are you going to just keep it shielded? And I was surprised that my ophthalmic surgeon said that even if it's a blind eye, psychologically patients sometimes do not agree with, they would rather have that blind eye, but they want it in position. Any experience on that aspect, and how do you address this?
So it is obviously a very big psychosocial stigma not to, enucleation, evisceration is completely different from an eccentration. In enucleation and evisceration surgeries, when we just remove the coats of the eye or the eyeball, it is possible to give very good cosmesis to the patient because the eyelids are intact. In an eccentrated socket, there is a deep cavity which forms. So on the face, there is no mobility of the eyelids. It's a stuck-on prosthesis, which is not very easy to accept, and it has its own issues. Especially in mucormycosis patients, a lot of these patients get fistulas. And there is the flapping sign because the medial orbital wall is not there. So the placement of prosthesis becomes a very big issue in eccentration patients. So if you can salvage the eye, even if it's a blind eye, it is always good for the patient in the long run. But obviously, if the disease is spreading and there is no control over it, then there is no point in waiting and saving the eye.
I think this is a very important aspect of mucor management. I mean, in the nose, you know, you have to be radical and just take everything out. But the eye is very, very different in how conservative or how radical you really want to do, be in the presence of disease. And I would like to spend a little time taking each person's on the panel view on this and how you would go about it. Danish, you want to go first?
Sir, I would say, I think we should recognize the disease well on a scan first, and where exactly in the orbit does it lie. If it's approachable endonasally, we can try to address it, and as far as possible, try to debride medially, and also keep the patient in a strict observation. We recently saw surgeries where the surgeon debrided from medial and the medial wall as well as the floor of the orbit, and preserved the globe, taking away all the necrotic fat. And if the globe itself is not involved, then we can make an attempt to save it and do an endonasal debridement in removing the retroorbital, the retroglobar contents, I would say.
Vivek?
Well, I personally have no experience of doing an eccentration for a mucor. But then I think I would still, as Dr. Adit had mentioned, it actually is a issue convincing the patient to get an eccentration. And as Kirtana sir mentioned, if it's a frozen eye, obviously would consider doing that. But then again, when you have a functioning eye, I think it's something where you should probably try to keep or try to be not over aggressive in the first instance and then take a call accordingly, because most of these patients would require serial debridement. So at least you could probably convince the patient, tell that the disease is spreading, and then probably take him up later for an eccentration if required.
So you think you could go layer by layer? You could just take the bone or just the periosteum or just the fat and then ultimately end up maybe taking muscle or even...
I think if we look into the literature, as far as mucor is concerned, we have a couple of new terminologies that have come in. I mean, it's not new. I would say it's probably there, which probably we are not too aware of. There is something called as globe survival, and there is something called as vision survival. So there are definitions for these. So globe survival is basically when it means there is no eccentration. You don't remove the eye, the globe. And vision survival is if you are able to keep at least a light perception or something beyond that. So this is something that we need to think of, because it is not about being radical. I mean, we have to be radical, but again, it has to be a controlled aggression. That is what I think it should be.
I think that is a very wonderful term you use, is a controlled aggression, because on one hand, you want to take everything out. On the other hand, you want to keep everything in for as far as function is concerned. Neelam?
I love that terminology of vision, survival and globe survival. And I think if I look at it, that's what it is. Paramountly, you will try and save vision. And if not, you will try and save the globe. Psychologically, it's really catastrophic for the patient when you remove that eye, however much we tell them that, you know, this is something that the disease needs. So in my experience, the first thing is if the patient still has some vision, but we are seeing some involvement of the eye on imaging, we are now routinely injecting retrobulbar amphotericin. We do that during our endoscopic debridement. We remove the lamina papyracea in all our patients. So we do an orbital decompression and we are injecting this amphotericin, just 1 cc from the nose itself. That's what we are doing for all our patients in whom we are seeing vision present and we are seeing also some disease in the orbit. Even for those patients who have lost vision, but the globe is still intact, we do give them this option that we are going to try this. Now, the idea of doing that is just to see whether in the progressive imaging, the disease in the orbit is progressing or not. And as of now, we've been able to salvage at least 2 patients, non-functioning eye, but at least the globe, as Vivek put it very well, is surviving inside the eye. The challenge that I'm having, and I'm hoping that Dr. Gupta can give me some clarity on this, is when I have disease only in the orbital apex. The rest of the orbit on imaging is fine. The patient has good vision, but the imaging is showing me disease in the orbital apex. And we have an ongoing problem here with the physicians who say that if there is disease in the orbital apex, for them, it's intracranial, which means this can at any time spread into the cavernous sinus and thereby have catastrophic issues there. So there is a lot of pressure here as to what to do.
Adit, I want to go to Amit on this.
Okay.
You had mentioned that local washes was not effective because it's vascular. So why will a local injection also be of any use?
Yeah, I agree. So that's why this is a systemic disease. It is known for angioinvasion and now we have good drugs which can reach the target better. So if the surgeon has done an excellent surgery and has removed all the necrotic tissue for me, has debulked 95% of the disease, then I think it should be the rest of the 5-10% residual disease or the relapse which can occur should be left to liposomal amphotericin B or the triazoles which reach the sinuses, which reach the brain, which reach the eye very, very well.
Darshan, you want to say anything?
I totally agree with Vivek, sir, that usually we always working in a team. So intraoperatively, we see that how healthy the lamina is looking after demucosalizing the lamina. If it is healthy, we always try to save the globe or save the eyeball. If at all we find out there is still the vision is there and the MRI or the CT is showing some disease, we do not touch the eyeball. Of course, the ophthalmologist takes the call, but we wait for the 2-3 days for that. If at all the eye is showing any worsening signs, then we only go for an excentration. Otherwise, early salvage, we don't immediately take a call for removing the eyeball.
Adit, you want to just summarize about the eye? What we should do.
So coming to answer Dr. Ved's question. So disease at the orbital apex usually would present with complete ophthalmoplegia and most of the times loss of vision. Now, this is my thought process. If the disease involves the orbital apex, it is already intracranial. It is already involved the cavernous sinus because usually the nerves which cause ophthalmoplegia are present in the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus and they just enter the orbital apex via the superior orbital fissure. Now, if it has involved the apex, there are only 2 ways to approach it.
I think we have got a frozen eye.
Can I just add one point here?
The apex as possible. But the second thing is not possible.
Adit, we missed what you said about the orbital apex. Can you say
sorry.
It again?
Sorry. So there are only 2 ways to approach the orbital apex, unfortunately. One is via the endoscopic approach, where you open up the medial wall of the orbital apex and hope that the disease gives some space to the optic nerve, and the amphotericin takes care of the remaining things. The second is obviously doing a deep excentration where you reach up to the apex. Now, I'm not a fan of deep orbital excentration, because sometimes when you are going up to the orbital apex and excentrating, you can cause a lot of traction and cause backflow and seeding of the fungus in the intracranial cavity directly, because the orbital apex is just an extension of the intracranial cavity. So I don't know how much it helps if you go and deep do a deep clearance of the orbital apex. But if there is no other option, and if the patient is progressing and worsening further, we are usually left with no option. We don't have answers for this right now.
Adit, if I may just interrupt here. So this patient has imaging disease in the orbital apex, but clinically absolutely nothing wrong with the eye. That's okay. My challenge now. What do I do for that patient?
So just open up the posterior ethmoids and the sphenoid sinus and try and inject amphotericin just at the orbital apex.
Maybe an orbital decompression might help, right?
Yeah, because that will give more space for the optic nerve to breathe.
Yeah, I did that, but I think this thing about amphotericin I'll try. Thank you.
Okay, we can also actually increase the dose of amphotericin B. If it's orbital apex at 12 days, then we can increase the dose of amphotericin B to 10 mg per kg. And it will be helpful.
Sorry, Rishit. One thing that comes to mind, we're having such a epidemic of mucor. Has anybody tried to find out from our neighboring countries, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, anybody, are they having a similar thing, or is it just an Indian phenomenon? And what's happening in the Western countries? Have you talked to any of your colleagues from these places?
Amit can take that. That is it more in India because we're giving steroids very early on in the disease, high dose, or are we doing something wrong which is other countries are not doing?
So this phenomenon is not there in the West. It's not there in Europe. It's not there in US. I have not talked to physicians of Pakistan or Bangladesh. But definitely we are overusing steroids. That is because everybody writes steroids nowadays. And writing steroids, especially in the first week of symptoms, especially in people who are diabetics with uncontrolled sugar, is a disaster, in my opinion. So, in fact, the government has come out with guidelines saying if you are going to home quarantine patients, you should not be writing steroids for them. There are multiple reports where in my hospital, almost 70-75% of patients who are admitted with mucor had mild disease. They had a CT score of less than 6. They did not even require oxygen. And still they were prescribed steroids. And the steroids which are being prescribed are not the low potency steroids. They are prescribing Medrol or methylprednisolone, oral, or Dexona, oral dexamethasone, which are the most potent steroids ever known to mankind. So they are going to suppress your immunity. They are going to make your sugars go haywire. And remember that India has almost 20 crore diabetics, and some of them don't even know that they have diabetes in the first place. So they come to know about their diabetes when they come to know about their COVID diagnosis. So giving steroids to such people when it's not indicated, I'm not saying that it does not occur in people who have severe disease. We have seen people being given steroids for severe disease and developing mucormycosis inside the hospital. But that is a hazard, risk which we take for treating the respiratory failure. But if there is no respiratory failure, no requirement of oxygen, and especially in the first week, giving steroids left, right, and center has to stop, in my opinion.
So the key message.
Have you noticed that these patients are coming from certain pockets in geographical distribution? For example, we've been getting a huge number of patients coming from Jalgaon and surrounding areas. So is it something to do with the location?
Yes, sir. Majority of the patients which are coming to our hospital are from the periphery. So Daund, Solapur, Sultan. And here, because the case number in rural area is so high, and the number of hospital beds are so low, I don't blame the physicians. They are under immense pressure to prescribe steroids just to keep the patient at home. But that is having a knock-on effect and increasing our case load of mucor. Because once mucor comes, then there is no way of managing it in the periphery. They have to be sent to the tertiary institute. So, especially in rural areas, steroids are just being written left, right, and center. And after this shortage of remdesivir, and shortage of fertilizer and shortage of oxygen. So bad news which is coming out. Physicians are of the opinion that we have only one, one weapon that is steroids, and they are jacking up the doses to unknown levels. So I have seen people writing steroids 1 mg/kg, sometimes even 2-3 mg/kg, with doses increasing from 40 mg to 500 mg, whatnot. So we are just getting scared and writing steroids for everything. And that is what is the major reason for this nuclear pandemic. I'm sure in Europe, in Australia, and in US, they have a regulation over who gets steroids and who doesn't get steroids. So I'm sure they won't be getting so many cases. This is a typical Indian subcontinent phenomenon, in my opinion.
And any reason why it's only mucor all the time and we're not getting so much aspergillus? I mean,
sir,
in the past, sinus infections with aspergillus were also quite common in the past. Yeah.
Maybe one is COVID also causes high ferritin. So iron per se is high, plus diabetes and plus prescribing steroids. So this troika actually favors growth of mucor. So high ferritin, high sugar, high steroids, and COVID-induced immunosuppression. These four things are actually favoring mucor. If we start writing tocilizumab and other biologicals haphazardly, I am sure we will get another epidemic of candidemia and aspergillus as well.
But in my work, of steroids in the last wave as compared to this? Why just this wave that we are seeing mucor? Is it something to do with the strain as well?
Yeah, there is something to do with the strain for sure. But maybe the cases in the last pandemic were manageable and we had enough hospital beds to admit all of them. Now that the disease has gone into the rural area, which clearly does not have the infrastructure to handle so many people, the physicians are under increasing pressure to write steroids. Maybe they were not writing so much steroids in the past. They are now writing steroids just to keep patients at home. And that too in the first week. So first day, the prescription is an antiviral along with a steroid.
So one of the questions, Amit, is if you're going to give steroids because you have a problem with beds and you're scared, is there any role for prophylactic oral antifungals?
So there is no such data. There is no such study. But if you are going to have people with uncontrolled sugars, where you are going to write steroids because the patient requires oxygen, or maybe he's going into respiratory failure, then, or you're going to write biologicals for him, like tocilizumab, itolizumab, where you know that high sugar, high steroids, and biologicals are with high ferritin, with high risk for progression to mucor, then maybe in such a situation in hospitalized patients, not in home quarantine patients, in hospitalized patients, I would prefer giving posaconazole prophylaxis to prevent progression to mucor. But that is a small subset, not for everyone. Hospitalized patients, uncontrolled sugar, prescribed steroids for respiratory failure, and requiring tocilizumab, where there is high risk of progression to mucor, maybe in that situation, I will prescribe posaconazole prophylaxis.
Since you mentioned ferritin, is there any role for iron chelation?
No, sir. No role.
No role. And hyperbaric oxygen also, some people are talking about it. So, no role.
No role. No role.
So, I think to put it in a nutshell, it is very important that no steroids are prescribed in the first 1 week when there's an acute viremia. If you have to prescribe steroids, do it in a controlled environment with a low dose steroid with a very strict control of the sugar, preferably in a hospital environment. And then hopefully maintaining good hygiene and clean conditions, sterile environment, we might see some decline in mucor cases. So let's go back to the nose for this. Just like we are doing this tailored approach for the eye, should we also have a tailored approach in the nose? So if you see fungus in the ethmoid and the turbinate, are you then going to go into a medial maxillectomy or do a full radical or only concentrate on areas where you see mucor? Yeah. Any of the surgeons? Vivek, go.
Yeah, so for me, it would be targeted debridement, in the sense not go with a standard approach for all the cases. So again, would depend on the extent of the disease. who take a call individually on a case-to-case basis rather than going for a standard approach. I mean, not an extended maxillectomy or a Dengus for all the cases for sure. I consider that only if the disease is going beyond the posterior wall of the maxillary sinus. If it is something confined to the ethmoids or within the nasal cavity, it's just a debridement in that area.
Local aggressive debridement.
Yeah.
Danish?
Sir, I have the same opinion. I think if we start seeing a healthy mucosa or a bleeding mucosa, then I think that should be the limit. But I would definitely like to have a look at the maxillary sinus because it's been very rapidly spreading downwards, giving another debridement and maxillectomy to the patient. So I would certainly like to have a view, I mean, rely on the view of the mucosa in deciding the limit.
Oh, no, Nishit, I just did a case this morning. Radiologically, posterior part of the inferior turbinate was blackish. I mean, what in the radiologically blackish. So we knew that turbinate was definitely involved. Maxillary sinus was completely hazy. Little bit in the ethmoids. Posterior ethmoids, sphenoids, not really involved. And frontal recess was okay. Now, the moment I removed the inferior turbinate and I entered the sinus, it was a gush of pus. Definite. I took the pus, sent it. That is not showing anything. Now, the question is, I had this pus pouring from the mucosa of the sinus. But if you look at the sinus mucosa, it's not showing you blackening. But I said, let me try and get a sample from the mucosa. And the moment I started pulling at it, the whole mucosa just peeled off. Now, this is what's happening. Normally, if you have just a chronic sinusitis mucosa, it doesn't peel off like this. This just peels off. Even in the ethmoids, when you try to get the mucosa for a biopsy, the whole mucosa just peels off. And you have a nice white, pale white bone beyond that. So I feel that if that is happening, then it's very likely that the mucosa is infected because you got pus from the sinus. So it's a little bit of a quandary. In FES, we try to preserve all the mucosa. And here you're wondering, should I scrape it off, just clean everything out, or should I leave the mucosa behind? So any... thoughts on this? Yeah.
Darshan, so suppose you have this situation or you open the maxillary, you see only one area where you see infiltration of mucosa, the rest looks normal. Do you want to strip all the mucosa and look at the bone or just be local?
So normally if the scan is showing that the maxilla is involved, intraoperatively the finding is supporting areas, there's some necrotic material we can see in the one spot in the maxilla, in the floor or the lateral wall. So normally I completely denude the maxilla off. As well as at the same time, I would like to see the ethmoids because usually when the scan is done, it's ideally a day old. And because the disease is rapidly spreading, I would definitely go one step beyond. I would definitely like to open up the ethmoids. If the mucosa looks healthy, then I would not denude the mucosa of the ethmoids. But I would definitely like to go one sinus forward, which is being shown in the scan.
Neelam, your views, and also tell us when you would like to do external surgery or transfacial surgery.
So I completely agree with Darshan. In my case, I would not just be focusing on that one particular sinus that is involved. I would address all the sinuses. So I would do a very locally aggressive debridement.
So you would strip off the mucosa, right?
That point about the maxilla. Hello? Hello?
Yeah, you're here.
That point about the maxillary sinus, I cannot feel is overemphasized enough and should be said again and again, because this is very commonly seen that when you open the maxillary ostium, pus comes out, but that sinus mucosa really needs to be examined very well. I would advise everyone to put in a 70 degree. Our experience, we are seeing a lot of light which comes out actually from the floor of the maxillary sinus. And look there, you invariably find this necrotic looking mucosa at the floor. We have a tendency to miss out if you're just going to do an opening into the sinus. I think that is something that I've started. As far as external approach is concerned, and this is something that I'm very disheartened with, at least in most of the physicians here, the general opinion
here is that ENT surgeons do not do external surgery. And you know, we are limited to endoscopy, which is really sad. We actually now are doing more external approaches. For me now, if there is soft tissue involvement or if there is palatal involvement, I'm already talking to these patients that we're going to need an external mastectomy. And I think with Mucor, we should be able to immediately change from an endoscopy to an external approach. This is one disease that really happens beyond the realms of the endoscope, especially if it is extended. And we should be able to do both, which I feel is something we are not talking enough about.
Neelam, we are getting a lot of feedback on your system.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yeah, no, it's still pretty much the same. Okay, so do you want to say anything? What about external surgeries? Is anybody doing a lot of external surgeries? Because we've seen the maxillofacial guys also are getting in on this.
Yeah.
And even with little bit of disease in the maxilla, they're tending to go with very radical external procedures. So when should we be doing external procedures, like a full maxilla with palate and everything? Or should we try and sort of hold it for some time? I'm still, I don't know where we are getting feedback from. Vivek, you want to take this?
Yes, sir. Open approach is basically if there is a cutaneous involvement, that only then we'll probably consider for open approach. Even for that matter, if I have to go for a palatal resection or even for a maxillar, at least in prefer a sublabial incision in these kind of things. It's a necrotic zone. So coming out. I mean, it's not like a classical what you're doing. So with that, I would just like to add this point also, because in the initial part of discussion, I think Ketanesh sir had raised a question on what when you get a swab for mucor. This is a very valid clinical scenario. You know, it happens many a times. And so we have ended up with just like what we thought it was mucor, then for a radical excise palate, and then it turned out to be an acute osteomyelitis which presented with the mucor. We had another patient just before the COVID wave one, the immunocompromised splendid presenting with a nasal, blackish nasal discharge. We went in, did an endoscopy, we found a blackish scar. So clinically, it was again a suspicion of mucor. But what happened is it turned out to be something called as now this is another form of very rare form of invasive aspergillus, which is comparatively resistant to conventional amphotericin, and this patient passed away in just a matter of few weeks. So now everything that appears black need not be mucor. Now although classically we see that with mucor. Now, we come across these situations. Again, osteomyelitis, skull-based osteomyelitis, invasive tuberculous osteomyelitis. Again, you won't see the classical blackish discoloration, but you see patients presenting similar complaints like discharge, and you find extensive necrosis of the bones. So, the important thing is that when we try or when we make that clinical judgment, or when you are fairly more or less sure that you are dealing with an invasive fungus, and when you are in a dilemma as to what exactly you need to start on. Now, the most common confusion that you can have is it aspergillus or is it classical mucor? Now, if you don't have the classical signs of mucor, as Sir said initially, there may just be a simple paleness of the mucor, so you don't see the blackish discoloration. Now, important point in those situations is that if at all we have such a situation where we are not getting a diagnosis immediately, I mean, where the pathologist or the microbiologist is not able to help us, probably the best option would be, or the safest option would be, to start the patients on amphotericin rather than considering voriconazole. Because if you see voriconazole, there are a subset of patients who tend to, if at all it is mucor mycosis, the infection tends to become over-aggressive over a period of time. Now, this is something that is well documented in literature. So if at all you are in doubt, probably the best option would be to start with amphotericin rather than considering voriconazole in this subset of patients. So this is something that I wanted to mention when the discussion was going on earlier.
So your sir, I muted you because your speaker, your speaker was on. So you're getting feedback. You'll
have to... Okay. We are disheartened because we're just not getting amputation. I mean, many of our patients are operated, and in the, even the hospitals, I don't know whether you're facing the same situation, but there is an acute shortage of amputation. And I really don't know how to proceed because you've done the surgery and now the patient says, I'm not getting amputation. We put them on isavuconazole. Even those are going to go into short supply very soon, I think. It's not going to be easy because the demand is crazy. I mean, never has the pharma industry faced this kind of a demand for that drug.
Yeah, that's right, sir. It's a very terrible situation where there is no medical treatment. Just one more aspect on surgery. Danish, you showed one patient where the cribriform was loose. So what happens when you have a cribriform involved, you have the olfactory fibers involved, and you want to be radical, but you are going to have a CSF leak, right? So on one hand, you can see that mucor is involved, that part. You may not have good medical control and infection can potentially go there. On the other hand, removing it means getting a CSF leak and then allowing access to the mucor directly to a fungal meningitis. So for everyone, what is, do you want to be conservative and hold it? Because to do a repair without a good bed is very difficult.
As far as possible, I try to debride as much of the mucosa over the bone, even the fibers, and leave the bony part there in the first place. And and I have had three such experiences till now, wherein one case was, of course, which when I was with you, when we tried to save the cribriform plate till the last moment, and we saw the healthy crust developing over it. At that point, we took a call, okay, now it can be left behind. Eventually, before the last cleaning, the patient got a CSF leak and we repaired that. The second case similarly was like a one year back, I did that before this COVID, more than 1 year back. Patient was chronic CKD. She was comatose in ICU for 3 months and her survival chances were very less. Her cribriform involvement was there. We did repeated debridements and she was on extensive therapy. I managed that case along with Dr. Amit Dravid. He is aware of that. Ultimately, the cribriform became a dark colored sequestrum. It was floating in the nasal cavity, and above that there was extensive fibrosis. So once we removed the cribriform, there was no CSF leak. So these two cases. And lately, what I try to preserve the bony landmarks, because for the same patient, I have ended up removing the osteomyelitic bone even after like a few months down the disease because of the patient's delay, of course, in spite of astenia. But then patient is doing well. She's walking around. And I have believed over the time that if we just give bony landmarks a chance to heal, then the osteomyelitic bone eventually over the time, over a period of few weeks, shows up and the remaining of the bone is covered with a healthy mucosa. And we know the margins definitely then how much to resect. I have had such experience in one case where we debrided the nose nasal cavity and did our best to give the clearance. Ultimately, the patient on the first follow-up was looking good with healthy mucosa. Second follow-up, I saw some darkening of the bone at the level of pterygoids, as well as she developed some maxillary osteomyelitis. So we had definite idea where how much to resect, rather than giving a huge defect and going for a radical surgery. If she's fungus free and it's just osteomyelitis secondary to the infections, then we can take a little delayed call on resection and saving more morbid surgery.
What are your thoughts?
That's been my experience.
Dr. Kirtane, what are your thoughts? On mute, sir. Sir, you're on mute.
Yeah. When you land into a situation like this and you see that cribriform plate floating, of course, he described a case where there was so much fibrosis that you didn't get a leak. But trying to close it from below by pushing something inside, you might possibly be pushing the infection in. So although I have not faced this situation, I feel that if I did face this, I would consider calling in a neurosurgeon and asking him to put a graft from above, so that you tend to isolate the cranial cavity from the nasal side. So that might be one option to consider.
even at the same time?
If required at the same time, or even if the leak continues for some time, if you're not prepared for it, you can do it the next day or whenever and close the leak. But trying to push it from below by pushing something inside, trying to get an underlay graft, you might be pushing the infection right.
Yeah, and putting a fascia as a barrier without any vascular bed would not have any meaning.
Would not heal.
Would not heal. Anybody wants to add anything else, or are there any more questions? Then otherwise, just check.
Got the same thing Nishit sent to me on a personal chat about that same thing about the orbital opens.
Right. So I don't think we have any more questions on the chat. So, sir, can you be kind enough to just summarize the symposium and what we should do going ahead?
Nishit, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
Shit, sir, there is a question from Dr. Charu Jagta. If you can take that on the chat box.
Yeah, it's more than a question. It's more of a request.
Yeah.
So we'll do that later.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. So.
Yeah. Okay. First of all, compliments to all the speakers. I think Sanjay really set the tone. One of the most clear and lucid presentations. He made it very clear to us, and I think with the pointers that he has given us, we should be able to pick up our cases much earlier, see the spread, extra sinus spread much earlier. And I think the whole game here is the earlier you diagnose and the earlier you start treatment, especially with the chemotherapy, the amphotericin, the better chance that the patient has. So no delay. Surgery has to be aggressive, at the same time reasonably aggressive, not unnecessarily or unduly aggressive. And we all agree that there may be limitations to surgery, which need to be then covered with amphotericin or antifungal treatment. You may have to go in more than once if you feel that you've not been able to clear everything at the same sitting. And try to tailor your surgery. I think what we've now done at Hinduja, Nishit, is that between the three surgeons who do the surgery, we show each other's cases to each other, sit down with the radiologist and actually formulate a plan of action that, okay, this is how we're going to go in. This is what we need to target and remove. So have a proper plan in action. Of course, you may need to change it because once you go in, as Darshan rightly pointed out, you might have seen a scan 2 days ago. And by the time you go, things might change. So it would be a good idea to do your scan once again, just before going in for surgery, rather than go with an old scan. And as regards the orbit is concerned, conservatism seems to be the order of the day. And unless we have solid evidence that excentration really improves the chances of survival. I think I came across one paper, which one of my fellows pointed out to me, where excentration actually was counterproductive. And it tended to spread the infection. And so I think the jury is still out on that, whether how aggressive we should be. Again, you know, we've been suggesting that we give intraorbital injections of amphotericin, not knowing how useful it is going to be and knowing how difficult it is to get amphotericin. But I think one thing here is that you could use the plain amphotericin. You know, you don't have to use the liposomal amphotericin here, because if you're going to inject it locally, I would say don't use the liposomal, but use the plain amphotericin to inject into the orbit, because it's not likely to have systemic side effects. And yeah, I think as Sanjay said, with every case we learn something more. So for all of us, it's a learning process, and sharing information within the surgeons who are doing this, within all the different specialties who are doing it, is going to be much better for us to take this forward for more benefit to the patients. Anishit, anything else you would like to add?
Sir, just one more point. I think one of the most important factors in recovery of a invasive fungus patient is control of that immunosuppression. And to me, sir, diabetes and sugar control is the most important thing, which if you don't do, then irrespective of surgery, medical treatment, your patient is not going to do well. If you can reverse the immunosuppression, you have a very good chance that the patient does well, which is why some patients who are on transplant medicine or HIV, whose whose immunity status will not be reversed, other people with poor prognosis as compared to somebody with a reversible prognosis.
So having a diabetologist on your team also becomes
very important. As Sir mentioned, talk to your colleagues and share information. If you're not sure of what to do, talk to your team members on oculoplastic, maxillofacial, anyone concerned, and have, as Vivek said, a controlled aggression.
So Nishil, once a week we are now having a meeting of all the special. Every Tuesday we meet.
Okay.
And whatever are the cases that have been with different people, oculoplastic surgeon, ENT, they all pool the cases together and we discuss all the cases now.
So maybe you can put it out, sir. We can join in with your meetings.
Sure, would be a nice
people
idea.
People who are interested. So thank you very much to all Dr. Kirtan as co-moderator, to all the panelists, the speakers, all the delegates for being here till the end of quite a long session now. And to Dr. Reddy's for having organized this at very short notice. Initially, it was just meant for a fellow group of 20-25 people, but Dr. Reddy's requested that if they can spread it to a few more people. So thank you once again, and Vimlesh, you can close.